Welcome to the Dynasty Nerds Fantasy Football Podcast, where we discuss dynasty strategy, rankings, and all things NFL. So get ready to geek out on fantasy football with your host, Rich Dotson.
And welcome to the Dynasty Nerds Fantasy Football Podcast. I'm Rich Dotson. He's Matt O'Hara.
Hey, hey.
He's Garrett Price.
I did again. Forgot to put that phone in.
And we are talking 2024 top 12 fantasy football running backs. We did the time. No BS.
We went to jail.
No.
We were incarcerated.
Bus stuff.
That's not how we come up with these, Rich.
That's not how you come up with these things, Matt. I'm best in high leverage situations. Very stressful. So we put
like
the time
the
in
back of a Volkswagen.
Jeez. Some things you don't talk about in public. We all sat down, did some notes, did some analytics
separately. And,
obviously separately.
Clearly. just wanted everyone to know.
Well, I've come in here, I'm studying. I'm torn between 12 and 13. I need your assistance. A lot of BS going on in his bedroom right now.
I need some pressure.
Put your pants on. Everything's pointing in the right direction.
All right.
Yeah, so we each came with our top 12 running backs. Mm-hmm. We have no idea. Anybody has this list so far. Matt says he has a surprise for us.
And this is just for this year. This is for 2024, not dynasty rankings.
Yeah, we should talk about that last episode too. Yeah, these are just for this is like our preview of redraft. It's our redraft episode. We give our top 12 guys of the year.
I think we mentioned the fact that this was
hopefully
a redrafty type of thing. But yeah, we didn't really put it out there at the beginning.
Next week we do our wide receivers and tight ends, and then we're going to do our bold prediction shows, and then we're going to be covering week one of the NFL season, how it went.
That's makes me so happy.
Who got hurt? Who didn't?
Well, I don't like that part.
This year we will have an injury show all by itself. So usually every show on Wednesday that comes out, we do an injury show. We usually put out a survey every year for Dynasty Nerds, the Nerd Herd, and kind of like get some report. Like, what else? How would you like to see the show go? So we're going to completely change up our in-season shows.
It's going
to
be sweet.
We're actually going to have a format. It's going to be segmented. And we usually spend about half the show, if not more, talking injuries on the first show and kind of like who they started. People are like, you know, I wish I could get this information earlier because of the waiver. So
sure. We're
going to do those shows Monday. They're going to come out probably Monday evening.
Can I just get a quick preview? I mean, J.J. McCarthy, done for the season, right? We haven't mentioned that anywhere.
Yeah, he's done for the season.
I thought we did last week, didn't we? Didn't we do a quick rundown?
No, we did not. Matt sent a text of a quick rundown.
No,
we went over. These are new injuries this week from last week.
Okay.
So J.J. McCarthy officially done for the year. We weren't sure last season or last week if he was done or not. Mm-hmm. He is officially done. Right now, Deontay Johnson is working on a groin injury and a foot slash ankle injury.
He came back today.
He came back from the groin, and then he had a foot slash ankle injury at the end of the day.
He went back
in the game?
Like 15 minutes.
All right, cool. Tyreek Hill right now has got his right hand has got a some sort of device on it, right? He's not catching passes or anything like that.
Gotta use lube, buddy.
Curtis Samuel has got turf toe. He's got a turf toe thing going on. We're not sure on that one.
Never good.
Never good for a wide receiver to have turf toe this close to the season. Jalen Warren right now, hamstring. Injury. So
week one's very up in the air.
Week one kind of.
I think
iffy.
Week one's doubtful is what I read. It sounds like a 6 week hammy.
Another little boost for Najee.
It's definitely. It says start of season is in doubt. Guys, we're not sure about, but they're dinged up. Jordan Addison has an ankle. Christian Kirk has just like a minor calf injury, but he'll probably be fine. Ricky Pearsall is still working on the shoulder. So that's a quick preview of just, hey, those are the injuries, you know, in our injury show. We'll kind of be breaking down what it affects as well in a quick format too. It's not going to be a very long show.
Yeah. I mean, however long it dictates. Usually the regular shows, we talked about like 20, 25 minutes. It all depends on the week who gets hurt. And then we talk about injury, how long they're out, and then who benefits from it. And a lot of times what we really talk about is like trade value that comes out of that. Sometimes like, you know, the biggest thing with injuries in dynasty is the trade value that comes from it. You know, with every great disaster comes great opportunity.
Right. And one more thing that I'm going to try to keep it tabs on. We'll see how this actually kind of flushes out, but notable returns. So Xavier Leggett came back, from his foot injury this past week and is practicing finally. So maybe we'll get to see him in this last preseason game, or maybe they'll hold him out. We'll see. Malik Nabers is back from his ankle, and I already mentioned Justin Herbert is back from his plantar fascia thing out of the boot.
Fasciitis. Sounds nice. If that was on a menu, I'd order it. Oh, let me get the fasciitis.
I don't know what kind of... Never mind.
Sounds like a pasta.
Does it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Fasciitis?
No. Sounds like a disease.
Sounds like an STD. That's what I thought, too.
Ooh, now you say it that way. I mean, focaccia bread. It's pretty close, right? Focaccia, fasciitis.
It's the is.
It's the itis at the end. Yeah, it sounds like something you should be taking penicillin for.
Yeah, you're right.
For.
If you're like, oh, I got fasciitis. I'm like, oh, where were you putting that thing?
Exactly.
Hey, Dynasty Nerds, want to revolutionize your fantasy experience? Look no further than Sleeper, the cutting edge platform now featuring our Dynasty GM tool. Get unparalleled Dynasty insights right where you play. But that's not all. Sleeper's new picks product is a game changer. It's incredibly simple. Choose 2 to 8 players and predict if they'll perform above or below their projected stats. No complex lineups, no salary caps. Make picks before or during live games for NFL, NBA, MLB, NHL, and more. Here's the kicker. You can win up to 100 times your cash with just a few correct picks. And it gets better. Use our promo code NERDS and Sleeper will match your first deposit 100% up to $100. That's free cash to play with, folks. Ready to dominate? Use the link on our podcast description or enter the promo code NERDS when you sign up. Double your deposit, access the Dynasty GM, and start winning big with Sleeper Picks. So who are your top 12 running backs, Matt?
Oh, you're going with me first again, huh? I did the honors last time. Let's go.
Garrett, you go first. I'll go second. Matt could surprise us at 3.
Surprise. All right. Let me get mine because I thought I was going to be prepared. Honest.
So, Matt, how's your weekend?
Yeah, you know, the weekend was all right.
Mine's gone.
So all right, I'll go first.
Go ahead.
Where did it go? So nervous.
Oh, there it is. I found it.
Not too late. I'm first. You're second. Matt's third. Sitting in a sidecar.
Dang it.
At number one, big shock here, Christian McCaffrey.
What?
Yeah. Funny stat about, we won't spend a lot of time on Christian McCaffrey whatsoever. He's
I wasn't planning on spending any time on Christian McCaffrey.
I gave zero analysis.
Christian McCaffrey averaged 24.5 PPR points last year.
Sure did.
The only other running back to average 20 through the whole season, Kyren Williams with 21.3. But fun fact is, Christian McCaffrey has never averaged under 20 points per game outside of his rookie year in 2017, where he averaged 14.3, averaged pretty much 30 points per game twice.
He's a cheat code. And he's not injured, he's going to be
winner chicken.
Yep.
Yeah, just traded for him. Just realized in between shows,
lucky ducky.
Gave up Kyle Pitts a second and third for Christian McCaffrey and a tight end premium. Like, didn't even know.
Good job.
You're like, who are your running backs? I'm like, this. And then you're like, who's on your bench? I'm like, I got this guy and Christian McCaffrey.
I was like, wait.
You said like 4 guys and then Christian McCaffrey. Yeah, we were like, what?
I'm literally like, why is he on my bench? And when did I get Christian McCaffrey in this league? I'm in so many leagues. I don't even know what's going on.
When did we get ice cream?
All right. So at 1, Christian McCaffrey. No need to talk about him after that. He's the consensus 1, right?
Yep.
At number 2, Breece Hall. At number 3, Bijan Robinson.
Splitting hairs. I got those the other way. But all right.
Okay. At number 4, De'Von Achane.
Okay.
At number 5, Saquon Barkley. At number 6, Jonathan Taylor. Number 7, Travis Etienne. Number 8, Alvin Kamara. At number 9, Jahmyr Gibbs. At number 10, Isaiah Pacheco. At 11, Derrick Henry. And at 12, Josh Jacobs.
Jeez. The guy that I thought was going to be a big surprise, he's got higher than me, so it's all good.
Pacheco. I have him. He didn't quite make my top 12, but he wasn't far off.
Okay.
Yeah, surprise.
Surprise.
Oh, you ruined surprise again,
Rich. I know. The surprise is destroyed. All right, so I'm going to go through mine.
You just ruined the surprise.
Yeah. It's not a surprise anymore. You did it.
Oh, okay.
You did it higher. It's not going to be surprising. I got Christian McCaffrey at 1. I have Bijan Robinson at 2. Breece Hall at 3. I have Jonathan Taylor at 4. I have Joe Mixon at 5. I have 6.
Oh, wow.
6, Jahmyr Gibbs. I think he's going to get a lot of work, man.
Dude, he's the number one guy I don't have in my list that I want on my list.
That's funny because you've been the one pushing him and we both have him in our top 12.
When it was all said and done, I'm like, where's Joe Mixon? And I was like, I don't got time for this.
7, I got Saquon. 8, Travis Etienne. 9, De'Von Achane. 10, Kyren Williams. 11, Josh Jacobs because I just put him in over Alvin Kamara in between shows. And then 12, Isaiah Pacheco.
There we go. All right, for me, I have the same exact top 4 as Matt. Christian McCaffrey, Bijan Robinson, Breece Hall, and then Jonathan Taylor. So we are 4 for 4 on that part. But I have De'Von Achane at 5.
Too low.
It's one spot different.
I have Matt. What are they?
You have them too low.
I have at nine.
Yeah, you have them too low. Saquon Barkley at 6, Jahmyr Gibbs at 7, Derrick Henry at 8, Travis Etienne 9, Josh Jacobs 10, Kyren Williams at 11, and then Joe Mixon at 12.
All right, yeah. So obviously number one's the same.
Top three, we really don't need to go too in depth.
We have a flip-flop where I have Breece Hall ahead of Bijan. I think Breece Hall, I think there's two running backs personally that could threaten Christian McCaffrey for the number one spot. One of them is Breece Hall, the other one's De'Von Achane. Those are two guys that I think can threaten Christian McCaffrey.
And why didn't you rank Achane at 3?
Just because of a full season, there's a small risk that he doesn't play the full season.
Okay.
He's not the guy. Bijan is the guy. And when we talk about Etienne, I'll tell you why I think he can be the number one guy. I'll get to that. But for Breece Hall, I mean, you're talking about a guy who, when you go back, they talked about how he was eased in, right, after the ACL last year. Didn't see a total. He didn't get over really on average 10 touches per game over the first four games of the year. Took off the leash in week 5, and then he just went and ran with it. He saw, I think out of touches, he was second only to Saquon Barkley, had a ton of touches there, and weekends per game. And when you take his points per game, he was fantasy running back 2 overall. Finished as running back number 4 on the year, but once he became the guy, he was running back number 2 overall. And honestly, outside of Christian McCaffrey, from that point in that window from week 5 on, he was the only he averaged 20 points per game, only 2.6 less than Christian McCaffrey, and almost 3 points more than a running back 3 in that time span, which was Travis Etienne. So even though Kyren averaged on the year from week 5 on, it was actually Breece Hall as a running back 2 overall, and he averaged 20 points per game, again slightly less than Christian McCaffrey, but 3 more than a running back 3 as Travis Etienne. So for me, Breece Hall, you know, I can't praise him enough. He's my dynasty running back 1. I think he's that good. They really went out of their way and upgraded the offensive line. They brought in Morgan Moses, John Simpson, Tyron Smith. They took Olu at number 11 overall. So they really beefed up the offensive line. They have an actual quarterback now, too, to kind of you know, take some of that pressure off as well.
But what about him stealing all the fantasy points?
Who?
Wasn't there somebody that was like making a point of that or something? That
Aaron Rodgers.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Like, oh, he's like overrated. Yeah, get out of here. And I was like, yeah, go ahead and call him Zeke Elliott out there. So for me, when it comes out, and I love Bijan. They bring in a guy like Zach Robinson as the OC, and he literally just fed Kyren Williams last year. And if you're going to feed Bijan like Kyren, yeah, Bijan's in this mold as well. I just think with a guy like Kirk Cousins and the weapons around him, they're going to throw the ball way more. Than I think even in New York. I just think Breece Hall, when I watch the two running back, Bijan is a special running back. I think Breece Hall is just a little bit more special.
They're both special guys. Literally splitting hairs between these two guys. I think maybe Bijan just has a little bit more juice, in my opinion. And that's really just like, I think that's how it's going to fall this year.
See, I think Breece has a little bit more juice than Bijan.
Okay. I think Bijan has got more juice and burst. And Breece is, I'm starting to confuse him in my own brain. Breece is just a smoother, he's like smooth as silk. That guy is
I think he's a very intelligent runner. Yeah. I think Bijan's more of a freak. So
that's what I was trying to get at.
Yeah. Thank you. The weird thing about Bijan, I have Bijan ahead of Breece, but like, I don't care. Put 1 at 2, 1 at 3. Coin flip, they're both going to be absolute studs, getting, you know, over 17 points a game this year, I
difference believe. Making RB1s instead of just one of those other guys at like the bottom.
The weird thing last year, only 4 times all season did Bijan ever get more than 15 attempts.
Yeah.
So he was handcuffed by his own team.
Yep.
Often. He also had a couple weird games that brought down his points per game. Like, he had one game where he had 1 rushing attempt,
3 yards.
He had another one where he only had 7 for 11. Like, he just had some weird games thrown in there, which happens
when you have a quality back like Tyler Allgeier.
You just have to force the football
to give them the ball.
So when you have a weird coach like Arthur Smith mixed with like weird inconsistencies that happen as a rookie sometimes too. Yep. So I think year 2 will be much better, and he's just going to be a monster.
Like, but you would assume Arthur Smith has a third nipple, right? There's something weird about that guy.
I mean, that would be, you have to assume that.
That's the most common assumption.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't have a belly button. I have another nipple there. Can you milk it?
All right. Four is where we actually sort of differ a little bit. I know Matt and I have Jonathan Taylor at four. You have him at six. Still not crazy far apart, but I know you've never been the biggest Jonathan Taylor guy. It kind of.
Calm down, Rico Suave.
Name one time you've been a Jonathan Taylor guy.
I had him as my number one dynasty running back like 2 years ago.
Yeah, like everyone.
Yeah, see? Go with the crowd kind of guy. Honestly, now that you say that, though, I have the most trepidation about Jonathan Taylor.
See, I told you.
In this list. It's not because of... Listen, when it comes down to Jonathan Taylor, you guys have him at two, I have him at six, and I have him there
because... We have him at four.
Yep.
You have him at four, I have him at six.
Okay.
It's not too far off. But, like, what worries me about Jonathan Taylor is a couple things. He's really only been good for his first 2 years in the league. And that was it. Like, literally it. He was running back one overall. His rookie year is running back six. The following year is running back one overall. Then he was running back 30. And then last year, 37. And
if we're looking at total season, sure. But on points per game, like, he was still a very effective back.
Yes, he's effective back. But, like, listen, I don't like those arguments because you have to be on the field to still produce.
Availability. I get that.
And that's part of the equation, but you also have to factor in, like, replacement level player.
I mean, this guy's dropping Lamar Jackson down because of potential injuries.
I'm just saying replacement level player is going to average you how many points. So, like, I view, assuming that a guy is going to at least play, you know, 12 games or more, like a good bulk of the season, I would much rather have a higher points per game player than I would a
100%
points per game. Last year he was 12. Yeah. Right. And I do think
that's not great. That's good.
It's an RB1.
It's good.
It's an RB1.
It's good.
It automatically puts him in this conversation, I think. Right.
Yeah. It's good. Not great.
It's good. Not great. I think the combination of him and Anthony Richardson being on the field together, I think those guys are going to work well together. Mm-hmm. And it's going to open some things up that weren't previously there for a running back like Jonathan Taylor. They're not gonna be able to just key on him in the running game, which I think can be good and can be bad, right? If he's stealing all the touchdowns, Anthony Richardson, it's going to be bad for Jonathan Taylor. But given the fact that Anthony Richardson, the whole season kind of hangs on whether or not he can stay healthy, I don't think they're going to be exposing him unnecessarily to some hits. So I think that's when Jonathan Taylor is going to be able to kind of cash in near the goal line and all that kind of stuff.
Maybe. And again, that's where some... I haven't run a back six, so but I want to say with some of this trepidation, everything you said was what also kind of worries me. When I look at Jonathan Taylor, you're talking about like when he's on the field, right? So if I look at the meat of the matter, which was last year, he played
10 games.
Didn't play until week seven. He didn't play 100% until like, he was like till week seven. But like he played from weeks 5 through 10. Weeks 5 through 10 in PPR leagues, he was running back 11. Then he had a bye week. And then the following week, he was running back 9. So he didn't have a single high-end finish in there. So his 15.6 points per game on the year.
Being top
three. Top four. Okay.
Top three.
But
top
if you,
I just again, wanted to know.
If you take all the games he played, he averaged 15.6 points per game. Mm-hmm. Good enough for, like Matt said, running back number 12. Also, you have Anthony Richardson behind a really good offensive line. Mm-hmm. I agree. What worries about Anthony Richardson is what we've seen so far out of Anthony Richardson, all we've seen is he doesn't throw to the running backs very often so far. And you could say maybe because it wasn't Jonathan Taylor, but he throws to the running backs on an average of like, I don't know, like it was like 10, 12% of the time. Not very often. But also worries me, again, it goes back to that goal line carries. The same reason we always got worried about the running backs behind Jalen Hurts and the reason we got worried about Cam Newton, the reason we're worried about Josh Allen is those kind of guys like to rush the ball in at the goal line. And we look at the games last year that Anthony Richardson was in, they ended up having they had the ball inside the 5 yard line 8 times. Mm-hmm. He ran it 3 times, running back ran it 5 times. So
how many times did he get injured? At least one time I watched.
Yes. So
at least.
So for me, I mean, when you look at that those percentages, yeah, I mean, Richardson's taking
he got injured 33% of the time. Yeah,
okay,
that's bad.
And he's rushing the ball almost 40% of the time. And when you got Jalen Hurts, he rushes almost 50% of the time. So Looking at these guys,
a lot of numbers right now floating around there.
It for me, it's just for Jonathan Taylor. It just gives me a little bit of worry of how it's all going to play out with Anthony Richardson to put him at number six. Like, of course, he has the talent to be running back one overall. He's done it already, right? Like, he's a very talented running back. But for me, that was enough to put him right in the middle because everything he did last year with, you know, Gardner Minshew came in and threw the ball a ton, as a throwing quarterback, not a rushing quarterback, and those were the numbers he put up. So when you take a guy like Anthony Richardson, put in the mix, I think all that can really do is somewhat hurt a guy like Jonathan Taylor, not necessarily benefit Jonathan Taylor in a way we'd want to. So it does give me the injury history, what we saw on the field last year. Again, very good, running back one, but like, where he's going, to me, I would rather just pivot and like I'd rather wait a couple rounds and just get Travis Etienne is a better way for me to put it. Like I would rather where he goes, definitely like if we're talking about like a redraft show. Dynasty is still pretty high in my ranks, but like for this year in redraft, for me to feel comfortable about it, like he's not my running back four. I'd rather have Saquon. And honestly, even though I have Travis Etienne at seven and Jonathan Taylor at six, when it comes from it, I just have them where I think they're gonna finish. Mm-hmm. From an ADP wise, I'd feel way more comfortable just waiting like two more rounds and taking Travis Etienne over a guy like Jonathan Taylor.
Are they 2 pounds runs apart in ADP?
I think it's pretty close. I mean, Jonathan Taylor's going like high second round. I think you can get Etienne in like the fourth round. So like two rounds later, pretty much.
Wow.
Is what I've been seeing. I mean, I'm in underdog drafts literally every single day of my life. So
somewhere I'm around actually there, in one right now, I should
see. So that's it. I mean, that's it. That's all I am at six. We're not too far off here.
And here's the thing. Any one of these guys could get injured. We talk about it all the time, and it's impossible to tell who's it going to be. If he's healthy, I think he for sure has this potential, and you mentioned it.
I did take injury out of it. It's just Anthony Richardson. I think some of the stuff that Anthony Richardson does is going to take away from him. It's some of the pass catching and some of the goal line stuff. And it's just enough for me to move him out of that top, like, four or five.
And here's the deal. Like, my next guy on this list is Joe Mixon. And the only reason I think he's going to be there is because he's going to be consistent. He's going to score probably 13 and a half, 14 points a game, and he's going to play every single game. Whereas I think a lot of these other guys, even in this top 12 list, there's going to be guys that are dinged up. There's going to be guys that miss games. It happens every single year. Especially at this position, it's just almost no one gets through it scot-free. You know what I mean? So that's, I just feel Joe Mixon, you know, at five was the thing that I dropped in there as a, hey, this guy is, he was six last year. He was running back six overall last year. He catches passes like crazy. He's not like a super efficient guy, but they're going to be able to feed him. He's big. He does a lot of things that I think fit that scheme specifically very well. And it's a better scheme for running backs than the one he came for. Not leaps and bounds. They're very similar schemes, but I think the guys running it here in Houston are a little bit better at it than the guys up in Cincinnati.
I do want to get to Joe Mixon. Let me finish with Jonathan Taylor real quick.
Oh, all right.
So with Jonathan Taylor last year, for me, I'm not too worried about the pass catching. It's never really been a huge part of his game. We've seen him be a running back one overall with like mid-range reception. So I think I believe he had 40 receptions.
I was going to say, in my brain, it was like 35.
Yeah.
Still pretty good.
It's solid. Yeah. But I don't think that's far outside of what he would get this season. Like, I don't think it's going to be drastically different than that.
You do need that to be a running back one overall.
Yeah. Well, he was a running back one overall.
I know. That's what I'm saying. You do need. Yeah. And I'm agreeing with you.
Yeah. Okay. So I think he'll get enough. I'm not overly worried about that. He's never been the guy that's going to get 60, 70 receptions. Like, that's just not typically his game. You factor in that their offensive line has only gotten better. They're projected to be the number three offensive line in football this year. And they're a guy, like, they're a team that loves to give him the ball in the red zone. And, like, even last year, he had more red zone or just one less red zone attempt than Derrick Henry did last year. And Jonathan Taylor missed a bunch of time. He had 31.
Missed seven games, yeah.
Yeah, so I still think they're going to feed him a ton in the red zone. I think they're going to give him the ball a bunch. He's going to be a guy that's going to be getting a lot of touchdowns. Like, honestly, I think this could be either his second best or his best season that he's had. Could be this year with this offense, with this offensive line, with the receiving weapons that they finally have to at least threaten deep. You know, they didn't really have any deep threats for the most part before that of any, like, anything that would really scare you. So, for me, all the numbers, everything I'm seeing points to he's going to be a very safe player, but he has the upside of an elite option because we don't have to even worry about Zach Moss this year. Like, that was kind of a weird anomaly last year because he played so well in those first few games that Jonathan Taylor missed that he was still kind of involved.
Annoyingly
involved, yep. And he's going to be gone. Yep. So I think that more than makes up for it for me.
So remember, I have him at six. Yeah. I'm right behind you guys. I said the only thing that makes me, this is why I'm worried about Jonathan.
Sure.
Those are what I'm worried about, but not enough to pull. I have him at six. So
let's get back to Joe Mixon.
My biggest omission is Joe Mixon because everything Matt said is right. And I do feel silly for not having my top 12.
But I have him at 12 personally.
But I also have Kyren Williams on my top 12. Now that's a big Blake Corum thing for me. But like, even looking at Joe Mixon, it's like, okay, yeah. I could probably, like, who am I going to bump out? Like, I could bump out Derrick Henry. I could bump out Josh Jacobs. I could bump out Isaiah Pacheco. You bumped out Alvin Kamara. I'm not willing to do that with one of the GOATs yet. We'll talk about that. So, for me, I have, it's weird. It's weird that I don't have Joe Mixon in my top 12. And I have no argument with you having him at five. And that's kind of weird to say that. Like, right. I really don't. Because I easily see a path for him as a pass catcher running back and just on the carries alone. And I'm the guy who sits on the show every single year and says, all you need is the touches to finish as running back one. And I always go back to Atlanta Falcons and Mike Davis year of making this very cut and dry example because that was the most jag of a running back. He could probably less than an average running back in Mike Davis, and he still finishes as a running back one. On the carries alone. And if Joe Mixon gets that and he stays healthy, he will 100% be a running back one. Like 100% he'll be a running back one.
Yeah.
So I feel like that's my biggest omission.
Are you concerned? Because I know injuries have been a big thing in your rankings. I have Joe Mixon at 12, so he did sneak into my top 12, but just barely. He has been dealing with like a hamstring and stuff that sidelined him for a couple weeks. Does that worry you at all? Because I know soft tissue issues have been a thing for him in the past.
Soft tissue issues have been a thing.
Sounds like a song usually.
And as an aging running back, it has to kind of factor in a little bit, right?
Yeah.
I hadn't heard of the severity of it.
He is back at practice.
I was going to say enough for it to be worrisome.
Yeah, he's back at practice. He was sidelined for a couple weeks due to a hamstring injury, but he's back and he's practicing now. But that is always something like with like, I remember Dalvin Cook had those all the time where it just like would always crop up at like inconvenient times. It seemed like,
you know, odd things that like stick in your brain when you're like listening to interviews and stuff like that. I was listening to D'Amico Ryan's on NFL radio.
Yeah.
And the host had brought up, you know, you guys do a really good job of kind of drafting and bringing players. He's like, but this year you kind of went out and got a couple of veteran guys on offense. And he started talking about Stephon Diggs and Joe Mixon. And it was just like it immediately gravitated to Joe Mixon and his ability to like not only run you, coming from D'Amico Ryans, who is a linebacker, had to face these kind of guys.
Sure.
He's like, this guy can just as easily make you miss as run you over. He's like, that's what I love about this guy. He's got so many dimensions and he catches passes so well out of the backfield. And it's just kind of, it plants a seed in the back of your mind almost a little bit. Like when coaches talk like instantly gravitate towards a guy and like, I like this and this about him. I really see big things coming for him. It's hard not to kind of pull you get pulled in like a tractor beam almost to those kind of statements. Like, oh, geez. Especially when you're doing these kind of shows, when you're forced to figure out who's going to be a factor this year. And a lot of times it's hard to figure out when guys move places, is it going to be a fit? I think this one's an instant fit. I think this is a great system for him, and the coaches there just want to feed him.
Even though I think it's too high, the one thing I'll give you is anybody that would have even like sort of threatened him for touches have looked bad.
Real bad.
Like Damian Pierce looks lost.
It looks like Jahar Johnson's going to be the two there.
Yeah. And that would be, I would kind of almost rather it be Damian Pierce because then it's like if he takes away any touches, it's going to be like between the tackles. Boring stuff.
2 yard run here and there.
Johnson would potentially be a guy that would take away pass catching. So that would be, I would rather it be Pierce, but I'm still not overly worried about either guy.
No, I'm not worried either. And it's funny because I have Pacheco in for like all the reasons you're saying Mixon's in.
Yeah.
Like he's the guy, has nobody to really threaten him behind him. It's like Denarik Prince and Clyde Edwards-Helaire. Like he's clearly the guy.
Carson Steele's been getting some love.
Who?
Carson Steele.
Carson Steele's got some love. But like, everything about Joe Mixon is like literally why I have Pacheco in. Like he looked fantastic during playoffs, got over like 20 touches per game in the playoffs too. Like
what I didn't realize about Pacheco was his receptions last year.
They were solid. They were solid. They weren't amazing, but they were solid.
44 receptions is pretty good.
Solid.
I mean, it's he didn't do a lot with it, 244 yards, mm-hmm. but to be able to get that kind of volume and then have a guy like Jerick McKinnon go out the door, I think was really what was kind of set me over the edge because he was I think running back 14 last year, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's exactly where I have him. I have him in the exact same spot. I think they're going to throw the ball a little bit more this year. So that's why I put him there. But yeah,
that's,
I mean,
that's he was running back 13.
That's 32 through 17. 32 targets are out the door. 25 receptions went with Jerick McKinnon. Mm-hmm. If he can get to that 55,
oh yeah,
60 catch range, that's like huge. Dude, you're in there.
And
you know
what
I mean?
The same reason Joe Mixon's going to get there. I feel 100%. And I'm speculating Pacheco, and I put him in there. It's by the Pat Mahomes rub that got me there. But you're right. Like, I saw Jerick McKinnon left. He's a three-down running back in that offense. Yep. And it's like, where I want to get Pacheco out, I don't want to put him in. Because, again, like a guy Joe Mixon, I talked myself into Pacheco, and I talked myself out of Joe Mixon.
I thought I was going to have to come out here and be out on a limb all by myself with Isaiah Pacheco. So I'm glad you have him in there.
Yeah.
And Listen, I was surprised when I was like looking over this list. I'm like, I think he has a chance to do this. Like I just looking at the numbers, running it down, like he was already running back 14 last mm-hmm. year. And I think 13. If you
13 weeks, 4 through 17.
14 with 18.
Yeah, exactly. Whatever. 13, 14, blah, blah, blah.
The rest are starters out there.
Yeah, but guys don't know like, oh, this one doesn't count for fantasy. Like they don't know that.
How many points do you have in week 18?
I don't know. I would have to click on it. Actually, he had
less, obviously, than his average.
He had none.
Yeah, because they didn't play. Exactly. That's why you don't count week 17.
But it doesn't hurt his points per game.
That's why you don't count. No, it doesn't hurt his points per game. His points per game average out there was as well. Hey, Nerd Herd, this is Rich Dotson. I've got some exciting news for you. Underdog Fantasy is back with their annual Best Ball Mania tournament. And this year, it's bigger than ever with a whopping $15 million prize pool. Best Ball Mania 5 is the ultimate fantasy football competition where you draft your team and then sit back and relax. No trades, no waivers, just your best lineup every week automatically set by Underdog. For just $25, you can enter for a shot at the grand prize of $1.5 million. Plus, there are tons of other prizes throughout the season, including $500,000 for the top regular season performer. And guess what? We've got a special offer just for our listeners. Use the promo code NERDS when you sign up, and Underdog will give you up to $250 in bonus cash with your first deposit. Don't miss out. Drafts are happening now. The entries close before the first game of the season. Head over to underdogfantasy.com or download the Underdog app. Sign up with promo code NERDS and start your journey to fantasy football glory today. Must be 18 plus, 19 plus in Alabama, Nebraska, 21 plus in Massachusetts and Arizona, and present in the state where Underdog Fantasy operates. Terms apply. Concerned with your play, call 1-800-GAMBLER or visit www.ncpgambling.org. In Arizona, call 1-800-NEXT-STEP. In New York, call 1-877-8-HOPE-NY. In Tennessee, call 1-800-889-9789.
Let's move on to De'Von Achane because we both have him at 5. You had him.
No.
Had him at 4.
Not so fast, Pat.
You had him
Jack.
At 4. I had him at 5. Sorry. You had him at 4. I had him at 5. You had him a little bit lower than we did.
I did. I had him at 9. And really, listen, I love Achane.
Not enough
for you two.
I'm going on
not
this
enough.
One.
But here's the deal. Achane, I think, is always going to be I'm struggling for the words because the ones that were coming to my mind were satellite, which is not correct. And like
small
ancillary. Petite, that wasn't right either.
Gadget.
Yeah. Like so he's always gonna be a guy that's gonna be 10 to 15 touches. However you get him, however he gets him, he's gonna be 10 to 15 touch per game type of guy, in my opinion. And this year might not be the year that he pops. It might be another year from now.
Nope.
Rich is going to say no, and you obviously think so as well, that because you got him at 4 or 5 as well. Yeah. I just think there's other guys still on that roster that are going to eat just enough of the workload for him to be 9, not 4.
Okay. Well, let me
And that's the only reason, because I love – we've been gushing about him all offseason. Every time he touches the ball, he's gaining chunks. It's mm-hmm. not like he ever is one of these guys that's going to get you 2 yards. It's like he's going to get you 5, 10 – 15, 20. You know what I mean? Like, he's that kind of explosive. I know, he's that kind of exciting.
I know you have some numbers on him. I have one that I'm pretty excited about, too. So you go ahead. Hopefully we don't have the same number.
Go ahead and go.
All right, so the biggest thing you're going to hear about De'Von Achane, who's my number four running back. I said in the beginning of the show, he has the potential to finish as running back one overall. I truly do believe that. Finished as running back 24 last year. Just recently in an interview the other day, Mike McDaniels was asked, he's like, why do you have Raheem Mostert and De'Von Achane listed as starters? He clearly said, he's like, listen, he's like, our roster and our starting lineup will be based on the talent that we have. He's like, I don't believe in a traditional, you need one starting running back or something like those lines. He's like, we're going to put our best playmakers on the field. He's like, listen, we have Jalen Wright too.
I mean,
he's like, what's to stop me from starting three running backs? He's like, the guys that make plays will be the guys that we're going to get the ball in their hands. And I love Mike McDaniel's scheme. When you go to De'Von Achane, you go, well, you have Raheem Mostert there. Raheem Mostert finishes running back number like three, number two overall, if you go into a certain time frame there. Like, what's going on there? Well, to be fair, De'Von Achane ate the most when Raheem Mostert was on the field. And you're right. He might only be a 10 to 15 touch kind of guy. But for the most part, I think he's going to live closer to that 15 touch kind of range. And when he was healthy, he averaged right in that range. He averaged right around 14 point something touches per game there. So you're right. He's going to average about 14 touches per game. In doing so, I can live with that. Because when you look at last year, who had the highest weeks 1 through 14 per game average, PPG? It's funny. He was tied with fourth overall with Raheem Mostert. In that time frame, they both averaged 17.8 points per game. Only 0.1 points behind the third overall guy, Alvin Kamara.
Are you worried at all that it's boosted and elevated by 151.3 point game?
No, because I think he has more of those in him. If you take away his game, it's gonna drop it down a little bit. But so what I did here was too is if you take his games, he played 8 games where Achane had at least 10 touches. Mm-hmm. That's it. So he had at least touch in touches. In the 8 games where De'Von Achane had at least 10 touches, he scored 183.2 PPR points per game, which averages out to 22.9 points per game. Would have been best for running back 2 overall, slightly behind Christian McCaffrey. I think he's less electric. I think he's dynamic. I think he... and what really gets me excited about Achane here and why I say he could threaten to... chase Christian McCaffrey for running back 1 overall is they've gone out of their way this year. And it's why I read about this earlier, probably like a month and a half ago. But hearing that Mike McDaniel interview just the other day kind of solidified this for me. And it really kind of solidifies De'Von Achane home for me is when they asked him that question about why are they both starters. About a month and a half ago, I heard like they love Achane so much, they got to figure out a way to give him the field more, that they're working him at receiver.
Can I interject because this is my stat to go with this?
Please.
So to emphasize your point even more. Last year, they're talking about doing it more. Last year, the highest percentage of routes for running backs run out of the slot, number one, De'Von Achane, 34.2. Nobody else even crossed 25%. And they're going to use him even more out of the slot. So those pass-catching receptions, which is kind of redundant, but catching passes there out of the slot could be huge in PPR league. So I think massive. That's that extra boost to put him to the next level.
I heard about that a month and a half ago when they first started getting to camp. Like, hey, this is a guy we want to get on the field. He's been working really hard and slanting really into this playbook. And in doing so, they want to figure out a way to get him more involved in the passing game. So while they have Raheem Mostert at one and then bringing in Jalen Wright as a potential, like another spell kind of back, they use De'Von Achane more in the slot. I did not know that statistic. I love that statistic. Can you just text that to me so I can write down and put it in the memory bank so I can re-quote it like it's my own?
Yep, absolutely.
Which is what I love to do.
Fantasy points data is where I got that.
Okay. To me, that more consistability of usage really propels him as my running back 4 because I can't put him ahead of Bijan and Breece because he's not that kind of touch running back. But he's that explosive where I can see, just like how Alvin Kamara has finished as running back 1 overall, De'Von Achane can finish running back overall. And I'm looking at, I got some stats here from John Paulson from 4for4, where he says here, like, and I quote, this is John Paulson, he led the league in yards before contact per attempt, 4.7. Yards after contact per attempt, 3.1. Was fourth in broken tackles per attempt with 126. He was first in PFF's rush grade and 14th in receiving grade. So for me, you throw in the statistic, I didn't even know that statistic where he's easy, they use him far that much in the slot.
And they're going
to
use him more.
And I thought they were going to use him more in the slot this year. He, to me, is the number one outside running back that you would not expect that could finish as running back one. This is for me, why I easily have him over Jonathan Taylor. Again, no disrespect to Jonathan Taylor whatsoever. I have him easily over Jonathan Taylor. There's not a single draft I would take in redraft, and there's probably not a single draft I'd probably take in Dynasty where I would take him over De'Von Achane. It's because he's that explosive and that dynamic. I think he has the potential to be the next Alvin Kamara of fantasy football. And when you want to throw that and by the wayside, more. We talked about Alvin Kamara. Alvin Kamara is one of the greatest fantasy football running backs of all time. His number of running back one finishes puts him in the Hall of Fame of running back, which is over six. He's up there with the LeSean McCoys. He's up there with the Christian McCaffrey. He's about to enter that category. He's not even there yet. Alvin Kamara is that great. I think De'Von Achane in this system with this coach and the scheme that they run has that kind of potential. And I think in a couple of years when Tyreek Hill is out of the picture, has a chance to even grow even more some. I think he's a fantastic Dynasty fantasy football running back. It's why I went all in this offseason to acquire more shares. It's why I had him so high on my rookie tape. If you go back to the rookie tapes, I will say that you'd be hard-pressed to find another Dynasty analyst that was pushing De'Von Achane as hard as I was. He's my number four overall rookie. I had him ahead of all the receivers. I think I had him ahead of it was like him and JSN is what I had right there. He's my number four over a guy. He's even exceeded my expectations here in the NFL level. It's why I have him number four, but it's why I said him, though it's weird because I didn't mention Bijan. I think him and Breece Hall have a chance to be the number one overall running back. I think Bijan, I feel really good about him being at like running back two, running back three, that kind of ceiling. I don't think he can get the number one overall. I could be wrong. Of course, he has the talent to do so, but Achane has the best chance in my eyes, and of course, Breece Hall to finish that boat. I absolutely love him. He's my number one guy I want to grab in redraft. If you go running back in the first round, for example, say you have like pick six, you get Bijan. There's a good chance, Bijan or Breece at six, when people go running back heavy. I salivate at the opportunity to get Breece Hall or Bijan Robinson in my redraft league, and then the second round comes, I'm in the sixth pick in the second round, and I get De'Von Achane. And that's the foundation of my team. I have so many shares of him in Dynasty, and I love it. I absolutely love the player. I think the sky's the limit. I said, you know, when I broke down, you go back to my old YouTube video, before even he got drafted, I think, I said, De'Von Achane, because I thought at the time it was Achane, might as well call him De'Von A-Plane because the sky's the limit. And boy, was I right.
Yeah. No, I think you said more than enough. Like, I don't think I need to, like, push it anymore because
I can't wait to see that clip on YouTube.
Yeah.
Clip that up, Peter.
Clip it. Snip, snip.
I love him so much. I do. I love him so much, man. From day one, from the tape, when I watched his tape, day one, he's the one I came in. We were sitting in this room. I'm going, dude, I really like this player a lot.
If he plays 14 or more games, I don't see a lane where he's not a top six running back. I just
14 games. Yeah.
If he plays 14 or more games, I don't see how he's.
How many did he play last
year? He had eight full games last year. Everything else was like, it didn't count. He got hurt like real early. Only scored like a couple points. Yeah. Like he had 1 point point.
So 11,
point
one, 11 like total, but there was three where he's kind of like
weird games. Yeah.
And you can see the point totals are real low. Like, no carries. Like under. I literally just count where he had 10 touches were the games I counted. That's it. The first game he played in, he only got like two touches. The other two got injured. So in eight games that he played for the most part, he was running back 24 in a year.
And I think there was a time when he came back and then he came back. Or no, he missed 1, 2, 3, 4. There was a bye. He came back, only got one carry, and then he missed the next game after that.
Yep. He got hurt.
Yeah, so it was. There was some definite anomalies in there. Listen, I love the guy. I think he's going to be great. I just think, you know, the other running backs on the roster are really talented as well. Raheem Mostert's a super productive guy for his, especially considering his age. And then they bring in a Jalen Wright as well. And the guy has looked fantastic so far from what I've seen in this system. So
I think
it's just for me, I don't know how to reconcile him getting that high. He could be at the top of the pecking order. I'm just not sure.
I mean, you can go back to, it doesn't happen very often, but we've seen Nick Chubb and Kareem Hunt both be top 12 guys, D'Angelo Williams and Jonathan Stewart.
I found it. I knew I read it somewhere too. Again, going by the John Paulson from 4 for 4.
Okay. I guess Raheem Mostert last year was five, and there was De'Von Achane was on that.
In the game,
he missed a lot of time.
Here, this is from John Paulson again.
Go ahead.
In the games that he played without Mostert, he averaged 17.2 points per game.
Which is right about what he did anyway.
In the games he played with Mostert, he averaged 20.1. And I think Paulson goes off of half PR, PPR, if I always remember too. So like those might be a half PPR stats, but he averaged 3 points per game more with Mostert than without him.
Yeah, that doesn't make sense because in the full PPR, it's 17.3 is what he averaged for the entire season.
It might be removing those weird.
Sure.
It was only two games he played without him. But he had
over.
I think Paulson's one of the best in the business. And yeah. If he says it, I believe it. He said he averaged more points per game with Mostert. So that's where I know in the back of my head, I'm like, yeah, he's just like that big notion of like, oh, with Mostert there, he's bad. It's not the case.
No, I get it. But what about how do you reconcile the third piece getting dropped in there and the coach saying, hey, this I could start three running backs because all these guys are great. I
think Jeff Wilson was there last year. Yeah. Like
Jeff Wilson's a bum, dude.
I get it, but there's always been another guy that gets annoying touches.
I think that's...
No, but Jalen Wright is explosive. He's a bona fide explosive guy.
He's Raheem Mostert replacement. That's what he is. They got ahead of it. They saw the most explosive running back in the draft.
I get
that.
They wanted to draft him. And I think next year it's going to flush out a lot better and be a lot clearer. I think this year is going to be a little bit muddy. That's it. That's the only reason I don't have him at four and I am at whatever, nine.
No, yeah. Raheem does what he always does. If that's last year, then there won't be
so argument ahead. We'll go to my number six here, Saquon Barkley. Where did you guys have Barkley again?
Seven.
Okay. So we're all within a spot of each other.
Where did you have him?
Six.
Five, six, seven.
Okay. Five, six, seven. So I don't see any like need for big discussion or debate on this guy. Dude. We all think he's going to get a lot of touches with a great offensive line and be a very productive
player. Listen, as long as he stays healthy, he's a lock to be a top-end guy. He's probably not going to be a top three. I don't think he's going to get there. But anywhere four, the five, volume six, will be seven, there. He'll be there to get in that range.
I think he could flirt with that number. I obviously don't have him at five. I think he flirted there. I think one of my favorite things I have here, looking at Saquon and diving deep in him, is, you know, last year he was running back 9 in points per game average with 15.9 behind a really, really bad offensive line.
Terrible QB play.
I know Pro Football Focus had the Giants as the third worst rushing line. They had the Eagles as the third best rushing line. And here's look at it this way, too. Miles Sarah. In 2022, Miles Sanders averaged 4.9 yards per carry in Philadelphia. Was running back 15. He went to Carolina last year, averaged 3.4. Yeah. So that shows you a lot. DeAndre Swift behind that line last year, averaged 4.6 yards per carry. Was running back 17. We can all argue that Saquon Barkley is night and day better than those two running backs.
Absolutely.
So, and that's all I'm gonna say, like for Saquon, just a much, much better offensive situation altogether. And he'll be involved more. Like some people say he's threatened in the passing game. I think he's going to be more involved in the passing game.
I think here's what I'll say about this Philadelphia offense. I've been wanting a running back to emerge in this offense and be the guy, and no one has. And I've been burnt on literally every single time. I was burnt by Miles Sanders. Miles Sanders was Carolina last year, but I was burnt with Miles Sanders before Swift that anyway.
Was there last
with
year
with them, and then Swift did okay. He did. He was an RB2.
Game to game was weird for him. He would have like amazing games, and then he would just disappear.
And that's what I mean by this. I hope this is the guy that kind of stabilizes this.
Gets at least
situation.
12 carries a game, and
but when you say Matt though, that the player itself, and then what you always like to look at too, that most of the money itself would say so.
Yeah. No, I agree, but They brought in a guy last year, and then, like you said, it was kind of up and down and up and down. So hopefully Saquon's the guy that does it. I've been burned enough that I have just enough trepidation in the back of my mind to kind of have him at seven instead of up at four. And I think he's got the possibility, like I said earlier, to get to four. I think he's that talented, and I think it's a good enough situation for him to be that high, but I just put it at seven because that's where I felt cozy, comfy.
I have Gibbs at seven. Where do you guys have Gibbs?
I have a nine.
Six.
Okay, so another one where we're not too far. I wanted to have him a little bit higher.
Just David Montgomery.
David Montgomery and him having a little bit of the injury bug already. With running backs, I mean, a few games could set him back a couple spots.
Absolutely.
And so
he was running back 8 last year. I put him at 9. I figured he'd be pretty close to the same thing. It's just, there's other running backs I bumped ahead of him.
I think they want to expand his role. I think so. And as long as he is healthy and able, and these little soft tissue things aren't an issue going into the season. I think he has a little bit more upside than he did last season as a rookie. I mean, it's just a natural regression type of thing. You know yeah. what I mean? So that's how I got him a couple spots higher. We'll see if that flushes out like that or not.
I just want to see what changes. Because yep. I mean, the splits on their touches last year, like, and I always take this for rookies. I look at the second half of a year compared to the first.
Sure.
It was pretty much 50-50.
Yeah, it was like very right 50-50. Down
the lane. Yeah. If anything, I think Montgomery had like slight edge on like a point something, like 0.5, 0.7.
For the carries, but Gibbs was getting more in the receiving game. Oh, total touches. Okay. Yeah.
Hey, Dynasty Nerds, it's time to take your Dynasty game to the next level with FFPC's Dynasty Startup Leagues. Whether you're a seasoned pro or just getting started, FFPC has a league for you with entry fees ranging from $100 up to $5,000. Choose from a variety of formats, including Superflex, Best Ball Superflex, Triflex, 1QB, and Standard. With weekly lineups, waivers, trades, head-to-head matchups, and playoffs, FFPC's fully managed leagues provide the ultimate dynasty experience. Most importantly, the leagues are here to stay. FFPC has never had a dynasty league fold. They manage the entire commissioner experience from buy-in management to fulfilling your orphans. FFPC is perfect place to expand your dynasty league portfolio. And here's the best part. As Dynasty Nerds listener, you can get $25 off any entry fee as a new member when you use the promo code NERDS. Head over to myffpc.com now to draft your team, manage your roster, and dominate your league with FFPC. That's myffpc.com. Promo code NERDS for $25 off any entry fee for new members. FFPC, where dynasty dreams become a reality.
I have Derrick Henry at 8. Where do you guys have Henry? You didn't get him in?
I have him 11.
I didn't get him in.
Okay.
And listen, and for me, that was an age thing. I think he's going to get tons of volume. I just think there's got to be a point when this dude kind of wears down a little bit. And I think he's going to get tons of volume. I just think he's going to just miss. You know what I mean? He was a just miss for me.
Same thing, though. Goes from a like literally one of the worst offensive lines to a pretty good offensive line and a run-heavy team. Listen, I want to fight. I want to put like where I was trying to like get Joe Mixon, like whatever. Mm-hmm. I want to get Derrick Henry out.
He was at 16 last year, huh?
He was running back 10 overall.
What am I looking at?
I don't know. But weeks 1 through 17, he was running back 10. Did
he not play week 18?
honestly, arguably one of the worst offensive lines in the league last year. So for him to finish as running back 10 in that league, having a guy like Lamar Jackson who's going to – like I wonder that though at the same time. Like the fact that you have to spy Lamar Jackson, does that hurt Derrick Henry?
Are you in standard? You must have looked.
Yeah, he was 16 in PPR last year.
He was 16 in PPR.
I might have switched. Sometimes when you go off, you know, in Fantasy Bros, when you switch from quarterback,
it automatically goes to standard. Which I don't know why. Who uses that anymore? Like, make the, at least half point.
Why is it? I hate that Fantasy Pros defaults to standard.
Yeah, I hate that Fantasy Data always goes to playoff stats first. Have you noticed that?
I have.
Anytime you use Fantasy Data, it's like here's their fantasy playoff stats.
Oh yeah,
who's looking at that?
Wait, he was running back 17, 1 through 10. All right. Listen to this, guys. I'm pivoting. Derrick Henry at 11, out. Joe Mixon in at running back 11. For everything Matt said earlier, Derrick Henry will not finish at running back 1. You heard it here third.
Actually, second, because I do have him inside the top 12.
I'm sure they heard it from somebody else, though, first.
Somebody else probably said it somewhere.
I'm going to benefit of that.
I wasn't even first.
No, you were second. I'm third.
You're third.
So for me, when you look at, you know, a team that is going to be a much better offense than what he just came mm-hmm. from, it was an atrocious offensive line. You look at his overall scheme. This is a team that is going to run the ball a ton every year. They're one of the top teams last year. Once again, they were the number one team in total run percentage at nearly 50%, 49.92. So 50% of the time, they are running the football. They're going to look to get him involved. Gus Edwards was actually one of the top running backs around the goal line last year. He had inside the 20 rushing, Gus Edwards actually had 13 rushing touchdowns last year.
Wow.
13.
That's some vulture work right there.
That's some great vulture work. So if you're telling me that Gus Edwards can get that many red zone opportunities to run the football and punch it in. If Derrick Henry gets anywhere close, like Just give him double digits. It doesn't even have to be 13. Doesn't even have to be better. With the amount of volume that he's going to get in this offense, I just don't see how he doesn't get inside.
It was a weird stat I saw while doing the quarterback show.
Hold on. Hold your stat for a second. Do you guys get turkey vultures down by you?
Turkey vultures, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I thought of turkey vultures when I said vultures. And yeah. I just saw today I don't know what the heck was going on around me, but these squirrels were running out in the road everywhere, and I saw about three or four of them dead, and I can't wait. It's like 2 days from now there's gonna be vultures.
Vultures everywhere.
Just clearing them up, man. Go ahead, Rich, with your stat.
Yeah, Lamar Jackson doesn't rush for touchdowns very often. Like, he's not a rushing in the red zone.
He gets
a
lot of yards.
Ugly birds, yards, those vultures.
Doesn't run nasty.
Ugly.
Yeah, vultures are gross.
Yeah.
I wouldn't French kiss one.
So that's the thing. I think there's going to be so many rushing touchdowns to be had for Derrick Henry. Like, if you – let's say he gets the exact same. 13 rushing touchdowns. Exactly the same. It's not going to take that many yards to get you inside the top 12.
Well, he's out of me and Matt's top 12.
So let me read some numbers for you.
All right.
303, 378, 219.
Fetty Wap.
Rushing attempts.
349 and 280. For a 30-year-old back, those are the rush attempts that he's been piling up since 2019 till now. And the 219, that was in an 8-game season. An 8-game season that he had 219
some
carries.
Bald-ass tires.
Look, I get that, but
they got to fall off eventually. That's all I'm saying.
Sure. I believe that that's true, but they signed him for a reason. Totally. They are going to run him into the ground. They are going to get every last little wear and tear
off
of those
tires. Did we say
that
about Tennessee? Like, they're just going to, like, by the time this contract's over, they're just going to run this dude in the ground.
He's still running.
Didn't he look worn down last year to you guys?
When you have the 31st ranked offensive line, like, everybody's going to look like that.
All right.
I mean, they literally had the 31st.
Listen, I think he's going to get a ton of volume. I think he's going to get a ton of volume. I'm just not sure that it's enough to get him in the top 12. He was 16 last year.
All right, let's move on.
That's just me.
Where do you guys have Travis Etienne?
Travis Etienne, I have him at 9, I believe.
I have 7.
8.
Okay, so we're all pretty close. It's kind of weird. Guy who finishes running back 3 overall in PPR leagues and going back to the same system.
It was on, like, weird injuries, guys underperforming, it wasn't like he had a traditional running back 3 season. Like, the points per game were kind of low. It just feels like he's going to have another, like, 16 points per game season, and it's going to be really solid.
Yeah, okay.
It's going to be good for 8 this year.
That's why we have him on the same spot. Fun ETN stat I have here. He saw 3 or more targets in every single game he played in, but 2. In those 2 games, he had at least 2. So he never had less than 2 targets per game.
And that's why he's on this list. I don't think he's a fantastic running back. I think he's in a great situation.
And he's another one that, like, he had a lot of touchdowns last year.
Yeah.
But not the stickiest stat ever. So
well, he's still the guy.
My bad. He had 11 rushing touchdowns, one passing touchdown. Or not passing, catching.
Yeah.
Receiving is the word I'm looking for. I'm out of words.
You had Alvin Kamara out. Did you have Alvin Kamara out?
I did have Alvin Kamara. Yeah.
I originally had him in, and then I threw Josh Jacobs in after our discussion last.
See, on a points per game basis last year, when you take those stats, I mean,
so good.
He was running back 3 overall.
3. He was really good.
Yeah,
running back 3. That's how I had him in initially.
He still finished as running back 9 overall last year. He's still there in this offense. They don't have a lot going on. Derek Carr's
still Derek Carr.
Yeah, so he's gonna dump the ball off to Alvin Kamara. He's the guy there. There's no clear, like, even like.
He's not going to miss those 3 games.
Kendrick Miller, Jamal Williams, does that shiver your timbers?
No, I think it's...
I think Kendrick Miller is going to be lucky to make this team. He's like, dude, you can't make... The coach came out and said you can't make the team if you're
not available.
Talking about Shike.
Yeah. If you're in the tub. Can't make the team in the tub? That ain't it. There's another saying.
Rub-a-dub-dub.
3 men in a tub? What? But
BS.
don't be a scrub. Get in the tub.
Something like that.
That's not it either.
the part for me that's hard, and I get it. A lot of it is predicated on his receiving work, and so on his receiving work alone, that could put him in. But it is literally PFF's last rated offensive. Like, it's going to be bad. Like, he's going to average 2.9 yards
PPR.
A carry.
It's almost like that whole team's getting old, and they're in terrible cap situations, but they keep kicking it down the can. The can down the road.
I don't have him in because of his rushing ability. I have him in because he's going to catch a shitload of balls.
He's going to get about maybe 600
you hope for him
yards
to get like I was going to say, you hope for him to get like 400 or 500 yards to at least get him there. Yeah. Like, it's going to be bad.
And 70 receptions. And the 70 receptions will make him a running back 1. Same reason why he's in the goated category, because he's a PPR stud muffin. All right, let's move on to our last guy here. I have him at number 12. You have him at number 11. You don't have him all because you're a hater and you like Derrick Henry. Josh Jacobs.
I don't have him out. I have Josh Jacobs in.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Josh Jacobs, man. I have him at 10, actually.
I have him at 12.
So I have him higher, so you're the hater.
Oh, son of
I got him at 11. Oh, man. Why you hate Josh Jacobs so much, Rich? Tell us about
it. Well, it's because he finished as running back 23 last year, coming off his worst statistical year that he's ever had, every kind of category. But now, like, he goes into an offense where, you know, they take out Aaron Jones and they put in Josh Jacobs. And Aaron Jones last year, he was banged up, but he saw 43 targets last year, caught 30 for 233 yards and a touchdown, even though Jacobs has come off a year where he saw 54 targets. But every year Jones was healthy in that offense, he was a top 10 fantasy football running back.
Yeah, he was very consistent. Up to
and the fact that Jordan Love has come out adamantly and said, I'm going to get this guy involved in the passing game, tells me that he's going to be involved in the passing game.
Tells me just that.
Hashtag analysis.
Yeah, I'm not calling that guy a liar. And I feel like Josh puts enough to put him at number 12.
I love it, man.
Listen, running back. You want running back to catch a lot of footballs. It's that simple.
You're not going to get a lot of analysis from me on this because you
just moved him up.
You guys convinced me in between shows, and I didn't even look into it. I was like, you guys are right.
Well, you look at it. The main guy that we thought could have a chance to steal some work from him was Marshawn Lloyd.
Yep.
Marshawn Lloyd already banged up, missing time. Like, that's not a great look for somebody that's going to come in and steal a lot of work. So I think another guy that's going to have a really good amount of volume, if he has good volume, work in the passing game, he would have to be one of the most inefficient running backs ever to not be able to be a top 12
guy. And he was fairly inefficient last year, 3.5, 3.6 yards of carry or something like that.
He was one of those holdout guys, though. Those ones are always tough at running back.
And maybe he was banged up, we didn't know. And every year before that, for his argument case, every year of his career, he's been a running back, top 10 running back. Every year.
And he's been way more
5, 10, 9.
And he's been way more efficient than that as well, which is why you would think, hey, this guy's gotta have a bounce back type.
He's still young. He's only like 26, right?
He came into the league super young.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think he is 26.
He was one of the youngest guys in his class. Last guy that I think some of us have in, some of us don't, because we've already talked about Joe Mixon. And we talked about Isaiah Pacheco. So Kyron Williams is really the only other one. I have him at 11. So obviously lower than consensus. I know you didn't get him in. Did you get him in or no?
10.
You have him at 10. Okay.
Injuries. Missed games with the ankle. Came right back in the playoffs. Had to get hurt his hand. Had to get surgery on it in the offseason. Small running back. So the injuries concern me. And then obviously the biggest concern I have is not outside the injuries is Blake Corum.
Sure.
He got good draft capital. He compares, like I said, Garrett, you could literally your comp for
Blake
Corum was Kyron Williams.
Yep.
They compare each other. They comp each other so well.
So well.
That last year they had to give Kyron Williams all the touches. I don't think that's the case this year. Historical data, we did a certain running back show. Historical data says, you know, he is the most likely candidate to fall out of that running back one by just historical data alone.
Mm-hmm.
With the injury history last year, like, again, the only reason he propelled up so high is the Mike Davis treatment, and he was effective in a Sean McVay offense. He got all the touches. I think if you eat in that some of that, it's just going to push him outside, right outside the 12. Like, he's right on that borderline. He'd be up there like Derrick Henry, Kyron Williams.
Listen,
he's right up there.
Where did I say?
I'm at 10. I have him at 10. 11.
10. I could see him going 14, 15, yeah. 16.
I am right
anywhere, anywhere in that range, I think, is kind of where he's at.
Yeah, I think the thing that I'm going to give him a little bit of the benefit of the doubt on is he was crazy. It wasn't just the volume last year. He was very efficient with the volume. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a big thing that gets overlooked a little bit with him, because we talk about these guys that maybe aren't that good, but they just got so much volume, so much passing work, so much blah, blah, blah. That is true. But in 12 games, he was still able to put up over 1,100 yards. He was still able to put up 12 touchdowns. He was still involved in the passing game and had 3 touchdowns in the passing game, 200 yards. And he was averaging 5 yards a carry. So, like,
gross.
Everything like he did really well. So, it's one of those where, would it surprise me if he didn't? No, it wouldn't necessarily. But I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt until he proves me otherwise.
Let me ask you a question here. Because I think those were all really good points. And it made me think of, if you had an NFL team and if you had fantasy, How would you see and who would you prefer between Kyren Williams and a guy that we just talked about, Travis Etienne?
Fantasy wise, I'm going to take Etienne.
Yeah.
NFL wise, I do think Etienne is a better athlete, and I think he's a slightly better running back. What Kyren does, it's really hard to compare the two because Etienne is lightning, like 0 to 60.
Yeah.
Super, like he doesn't have amazing long speed, but his acceleration is really good. Catch the ball really well. Kyren Williams is like a subpar athlete, but he does all of the little things well, and he's got excellent vision.
Yeah. That's the hard part.
So, like,
to me, they're very fair. If you take Etienne and you put him in Sean McVay's offense,
he'll do the exact same thing.
He's going to do better.
I don't
see maybe. That's what I'm not sure about because I'm not sure he's an efficient.
I don't know if he's going to be able to read the holes as well as Kyren Williams.
I think it would nothing to do with him. I think McVay would scheme him.
I would agree with that. He would do what Travis Etienne does well. And McVay's really good at making sure that those guys are in positions to do it. Like, we're seeing it even now with Jordan Whittington. Like, Jordan Whittington, it was not a good receiver.
He had Cam Akers on that. And I guess we never know because
of the injury.
It's like Kyle Shanahan. Every running back, like I said before, I want the San Francisco running back, right? Yeah. Elijah Mitchell. Who's the running back? They was it in the playoffs where he was in there just for a couple.
Jordan Mason, maybe.
It was Elijah Mitchell, but it was somebody else. It was for a real short
that
window.
One like got dumped, man.
Matt Breda, Jeff Wilson.
Like everybody in that system looked really good. I think Kyren Williams is a good enough running back in the right system, which is Sean McVay's system, that he looked really good. It's the same reason, like would De'Von Achane be just as good in a different system? No. Probably not, right?
He's a hand and glove fit for that system.
Exactly. So that means everything. And Sean McVay's so good, he's gonna bring the absolute best out of everybody and put you in the best position to succeed. And that's where it happens. So I think if you take like a Travis Etienne, you put in that system, he's gonna be better. And honestly, I think a ton of other running backs would be better in that system. I think and that's not a diss to Kyren Williams. Like what he did in the NFL, that's an extreme talent. It really is. When you take that and they invest the draft capital in a Blake Corum like that, when they didn't even have a lot of draft picks in to go with, that tells me
definitely
like,
concerning.
They're probably like, hey, he got banged up last year. He's a little smaller, a little bit more fragile. We probably overworked him. We probably got to bring him in a little bit of help here. Let's get a guy that complements him really well, like Blake Corum.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that he did everything he did, he was very efficient, but he did that in such an abundant amount of carries because he did all that with, like, I think nobody else got more carries than him in the touches in the league. It was like him.
Well,
Saquon, when he came back,
he was up there. CMC had the most last year.
On a per game basis, though.
Oh, on a per game, yeah. I don't know. Like I'd have to look. He was definitely up there as a top five guy.
Yeah, on a per game basis. So it just comes down to, like, again, that Mike Davis theory, right? Like, if you get all the touches, you could be a running back 12. If you get all the touches in a right offense and you're like slightly better than a Jag, you're going to be running back 3 overall.
Right.
Like, that's how it works out to me. So, like, I'm always going to bet on the talent sometimes a little bit more so. The injury history, the fact that Blake Corum, just enough to push him out. That's a guy I knew I'd probably get, like I'd be on the outside looking in for, but I'd easily take Joe Mixon ahead of him easily. I don't want to say easily because it sounds stupid for a guy who was so good last year.
Yeah,
I just have my concerns.
Yeah, that's I think all. It's fair. I think it's absolutely fair.
Next week, doing the same shows, no BS. So
no BS.
Because it's not in.
RS and ES.
Yeah, we're gonna talk about tight ends instead.
Got so excited. Really did. Yeah, you love the tight end.
Always do.
Adios.